This is Grandmaster Alex Chermolinsky, and welcome back. Game of the Week coverage from the US Chess League. That was League 5, and, Week 5, pardon me. And it's a memorable week for me, because that week was my debut as the broadcaster, together with my client, my colleague. We had a whale of a time that Tuesday night, going over a lot of games and finishing in style, you know, after 6 hours of broadcasting, finally wrapping it up, you know, when the last game finished, when one player could not win the endgame, Queen against Strook. So we had it all. We had a lot of fun. One thing we didn't have Game of the Week, because the Game of the Week actually was to be played the following day. That the winner is Joe Benjamin. For the second time already in the young season, he takes the top honors by defeating Dmitry Schneider. Alright, so let's move on. Schneider was white. Schneider I know very well. He's an attacking player, together with his brother Igor. Well, they play nearly the same style. They like to play e4, and particularly like playing against a Sicilian. Benjamin plays e5, but as luck would have it, eventually they would get into Sicilian kind of a position, coming from the Philidor. You see, the thing is, Joe likes to play this line. He played it before, more than once. Although the game I remember the best, when knight takes d4, and then Joe lost on the black side of this against Jacek Stopa, a Czech grandmaster who I believe used to study in Dallas, in the university there, UTD at Dallas. Yeah, that was an interesting game, but Joe is not done over there, so he would like to try that unusual Philidor again. So he takes on d4, but Schneider comes in with a surprising move, queen takes d4, specifically designed to avoid some of these variations. Now, well, it's clear that if black goes knight c6, then we got bishop b5, and this is Roy Lopez, Steinitz defense. I guess white's happy with that. So the move a6 was played by Joe. Now, this whole thing is like the... It's just like a Sicilian, but the pawn is there on c7 instead of e7. Generally speaking, white is supposed to get bigger advantage, if you wish, having his pawn on e4 against this pawn structure, rather than on the Sicilian, because there is no clearly defined counterplay on the c-file. But that doesn't seem to bother Joe. Okay, this nice counterattack. Obviously, bishop takes queen, knight takes queen, and then you don't have the time to take that pawn because of the fork on c2. So Schneider wisely goes back, and now comes bishop e7. I guess this exchange would help black because his bishop is not that well positioned, but anyway, h4. This surprisingly has been played already in some titled players' games. h6, this is not forced, but it's possible to. And after this, previously known was bishop e6, developing move. White, of course, castles long, and then, interesting maneuver here. Then put the bishop out. Obviously, black is in no hurry to take on d5, because that would probably open the e-file and... more play for white. So he's more interested in taking good control over the e5 square. And here I can see there is one problem here with white's attacking setup. If he cannot break through in the center immediately, then he's gonna be slow getting his pawns involved, because the f2 pawn is blocked by his own pieces, and the g pawn cannot go to g4. That is also obvious, because, well, it's not supported. So not so clear how white is going to continue with his attack. But Benjamin played a more direct counter-attacking move. He played b5. Well, white, who's planning to cast long obviously doesn't want to spend time and on move like A3 and also weaken the king potentially when black can still play before and open up a file. So what to do? I guess it would be possible to play bishop d3. Maybe he just didn't think it was much of an attacking move. Indeed, it blocks the queen, but it's just a developing move. Also, white could play e5, but e5 doesn't really bring anything. Nothing tangible here, really. I mean, where is white's advantage? The center is totally open. Black can develop that bishop on the nice long diagonal. He can castle. I mean, there is some temporary inconvenience having the bishop on d8, protecting that pawn on c7, but it doesn't look permanent. So I guess that's not enough. And finally, what Schneider did, which was a very principled decision. So he goes castles long, invites this b4 move, and sacrifices the central pawn. Now queen f3, knight c5. Really, on the face of it, black is about to suffer for, you know, for that pawn that he took. But I mean, white needs to decide, needs to choose rather, between some kind of general purpose developing move, such as bishop c4, and what Schneider did in the game. Well, also, I would mention that white had this possibility. How about queen takes c5? Let's see. Now this. Well, you probably have to take that knight, because you're losing your queen anyway, and then you're gonna lose that rook. So, it's better for black to take. Now, what kind of position is this? Once again, pawns are equal. I don't know, maybe bishop e6 black plays, or maybe castles and puts the bishop out to g4. Well, you know, it doesn't really feel like a quiet endgame position. It's a queenless middle game, and black is thinking of occupying that d4 square with the knight. I mean, maybe black would suffer if the game goes distance and white manages to force some exchanges because of this pawns on c5 and a6. But not clear. Maybe he can get enough play going. So I guess that did not convince Dmitry Schneider. So he didn't think that was the way to go. So he played a somewhat similar idea, but nice. And rook takes d6. Interesting. So, the bishop on e7 is pinned, and then this knight is hanging, and of course, white is thinking of moving that rook away elsewhere. Possibly even rook takes h6. How about that, eh? And discover the attack on the queen and win the game. Now, in this situation, well, from Schneider's point of view, I don't know, he probably calculated something, but maybe he missed Benjamin's reply. Now, this move played by Joel was called the move of the week, and indeed, it's a striking move. By the way, when you see this position, if you had to guess the opening, for sure you would say the Sicilian, right? The queen on c7, the A and B pawns advanced like this. And then Sicilian, obviously, motif is always counterattack on the white king, and then maybe king is not ideal after, you know, the castles long. That's why many Sicilian players would spend a move on playing king b1. Not only Peter Lecco, who's not really your model Sicilian player anyway. Anti-Sicilian. But anyway, king b1, but white didn't have the time to do this. So now he has some issues here, and I gotta tell you this, that maybe I cheated a little bit. When I went on our website, US Chess League website, to learn well, that selection, I will tell you a little bit more about it, but the thing is, you know, that I'm not the one who chooses. I'm the one who analyzes the game and makes this video. There is a panel of independent experts, judges, if you wish, who vote. They're given a choice of three games and they rank them from 1 to 3, and well, and then they count total points, and this game won. And then they write little short blurbs, and sometimes not too short. We'll talk about this later. And I got most help from a young player, Alexander Ostrovsky, who really liked this game and analyzed it. And, well, I mean, I don't want to quote you the variations that he gave. You can see it yourself. But basically, there is always this counterattack. For example, in this line, you make good on your main threat, and then the pawn is extremely annoying. You just can't stop it, and it's gonna deflect your queen. Some bishop takes d6, and black is at least gonna win a piece, maybe more. Maybe you could have done more by playing queen a5 here, but, I mean, it's bishop takes d6 is enough. So white needs to pay some attention there. The idea, of course, is to clear the b4 square. And it doesn't even matter if white plays a takes b3, then there is knight b4. And there are the threats going against the c2 square. Yeah, and then, of course, this is possible. So there are variations like this. I'm not actually sure, you know, this is the best way to play for black, but I mean, there are many variations possible here. That one line I looked at was a3, but it actually doesn't stop black from playing knight b4. He also has this idea. If takes, right? Uh-huh. Now, knight e6. So that opens up the queen on this mate and attacks the bishop and unpins that bishop so he can take on d6. So this is basically how black takes over the game. So he solves the main problem, that awkwardness of his knights on the c-file. In a way, b3 is just a tempo move to unload the c-file. So, all good. And I looked at all that, and b3 is indeed the best move in the position. Now, bishop c4 was played. It's a typical move of an attacking player in the Sicilian. But I know this was not a Sicilian, but Sicilian-like position, which never quits and always believes that he should play the developing moves and tactics will somehow work out for him. Well, this move was criticized by Ostrovsky. Now I'm of a different opinion. So after all this was played, and bishop takes f7, great shot. Now white is ready to win the queen. Actually, I don't think that white is better here. Possibly it's black is better, because he has enough pieces. He has rook and bishop and knight for a queen. But I'm not sure. With the king open like this, there is no guarantee. So black still needs to coordinate his pieces. No, alright, maybe black is not better, so it's unclear. Alright. But Benjamin, of course, played much better move, so he declined this sacrifice. Now what? So once again, if you move that rook away, then you get hit by this Knight d3. Knight cd3. That's the main threat. So he played bishop g6 to protect against it, but it didn't quite protect. So this move is very good, deflecting the bishop. Now, there is no mate anymore. The bishop had to leave g6. And now Benjamin collects. Now, Ostrovsky in his analysis pretty much concludes this and says, well, and then White tried a few tricks, but no, well, he just had to bow down because, no, Black has more material. Indeed, Black has an extra rook here. But this is probably the most difficult moment to understand about this game. It took me a while, it took me some effort to force myself to think. And instead of the move bishop e4, that indeed, everything fizzled out very quickly. There is this move bishop c4, directly designed to keep the h8 rook out of play. And believe me or not, I could not find any advantage here for Black. The game would have just begun right here if Dmitry found the move bishop c4. I guess that's what it is for Dmitry. You know, I followed his chess career a bit, we played, but he has... Well, he shows a lot of ideas and an energetic play, but sometimes you get a feeling that it just comes maybe one or two moves short. And this is the case. Well, not every time things gonna go your way from the first try. So maybe you need to keep your faith and play positions like this. Well, okay, I would mention Larry Christensen, for example. You know, he never quits. Alexander Shabalov. Those attacking players are successful because they never quit. Now, what to do for Black? I looked at a bunch of moves. I looked at this. Oh, say we start with knight c6. That I didn't like at all for Black. Check. Now this. A direct threat rook d6. White has some domination here. And just going after that knight. If the knight goes away somewhere, White can jump with his knight to e5. And there you go, knight g6 check. You wanna try to stop that? Maybe... Oh, you can play knight d5, of course. I looked at that too. Knight d5. Now, surprisingly somewhat, White can take. Play this move. Threatening to come to d8. So the only move Black's got is queen over there, and now knight... No, queen e4 first. Yeah, queen e4. Now, checks nothing, because you just come out, and the rook's under attack. That's the main thing. Black's totally disorganized here. Now go knight e5. Take control of d7, so the check once again is nothing, and just threaten your knight g6 check. I think Black has to play queen a1 maybe, and then queen back. But then he agrees to a draw. I don't see how he can cover the g6 square. And finally, the move that is designed to cover the g6 square, that would be bishop f5. But then White's got like knight d4. This. It's so difficult to develop your pieces. Well, I mean, the bishop cannot go along that diagonal. Knight e6 check. White is beginning to make threats. Maybe he has the threat of knight. Oh, knight takes f5 followed by mate on e7, of course. No, this is anyone's game, people. Now, one last thing, you know, before I sign off. I told you already that I read those comments by panel judges, and, well, I learned some interesting things, and I quoted Ostrovsky in particular. But one of these guys, you know, well, his comments, you know, struck me as strange. That's Feeder Master Alex Burnett. I don't know if I can quote him exactly, but he said things such as, it's a hilarious game. Hilarious? Don't know. Well, so many obvious mistakes, but I just have to give it top honors because of its entertaining value. Well, please point out the mistakes. Well, obviously, well, in chess game there are always mistakes, but point them out. Instead of pointing out mistakes, our esteemed panel expert goes on saying, I'm a tactical player, and I appreciate games like this, and I love playing Blitz, and this is like one of my bullet games on ICC. Oh, really? You play like that with 1 minute on your clock? So how come you're not world champion? And talking about, well, referring to oneself as a tactical player, I always thought that first you have to earn your stripes, maybe make it top 20 in the world at one time or another, or be dead. Then people will be talking about your style and whatnot, you know, over here. And then the last comment, something about street chess. And maybe here I really need some additional comment on this, some kind of clarification. What the heck is street chess? Is that when you play chess with your pants down your ankles? Anyway, guys, thank you for your attention. This was Grandmaster Alex Chermolinsky doing his version of Game of the Week. Take care.